All right, welcome to twitch.tv/evilsqueegee. I am Evil Squeegee. Let's get a round of applause because we actually have D&D today.
Yay! It finally happened! Woohoo!
The guests, meanwhile, don't give a fuck.
It's been like... Shit, it's been like 2 weeks. Everdeep has been on the mend. It suffered an aggravated wound at the hands of technical difficulties, but we are back. We are back, and I am in a very dark room, but my face is very pale. I think it's very high contrast. It means you'll be looking at my face instead of whatever the hell that thing is. Oh, that's my door. Awesome. It's also closed. Sweet. Before we get going here today, if this is your first episode of Everdeep, do not fear. Every episode of Everdeep is a perfectly fine episode to start. Everdeep on, it's all one-shots. We like to keep everything contained in the episodes. But if you do go back and you watch all the Everdeeps in a row, you might actually be able to, like, watch the evolution of a game master figuring out what the fuck he's doing. But also, we've got a special guest today, Eli and Nerd Immersion. Why don't we go around the table here and Kajer? I can find you on Thursdays, can't I? On Thursdays, yes, Thursdays. Tomorrow, even.
Sorry?
Holy shit, tomorrow is Thursday.
Yes.
Also Thanksgiving.
Oh.
Also Thanksgiving.
Oh, all right, so, since at least half of our cast is not going to be wrapped up in Thanksgiving plans on Thursday, I imagine we'll probably run something. It'll be the Adventures of War of Attrition and Spanner in the Works. So don't miss tomorrow where you can catch Kajer. You can also catch Kajer on Fridays. Did I miss something? I think I missed something, didn't I?
Yeah.
What did I miss, Kajer?
You missed Mondays.
Oh, where can they find you? What will they find you doing on Mondays and where?
Well, you'll still find me here, but we just launched Intelligent Design this past Monday, and we created, what did we call it, Zangmac? It was The World's Gone Nuts, right?
The World's Gone Nuts.
Oh, you're doing the crowdsourced like module creation and faction creation, all that stuff.
Yeah, we did module creation to start with. We might do some more module creation in the future, but we're going to be jumping into god and faction creation this coming week. But we created an adventure wherein the party had to defeat the pirate squirrel army that was invading. And they had to...
fucking chat, man.
They had to seduce the ugly succubus and compete against Satan trapped in the body of a little girl in order to accomplish this.
Lucy.
Yeah, Lucy.
Specifically.
Right. And Zangmac, I heard you've been cutting in on my turf.
Specifically not cutting in on your turf is the arrangement that we have. But, I've started streaming in the past couple of weeks. I'm now in week 3, 2, sometime.
Something.
It'll be almost on the first.
Almost every day. Almost every day.
Pretty much, yeah. There's been a couple of days off, but yeah, I've...
And you do what? You do mapping and you do ARC?
ARC RP server on MythRP, and I do mapping, and I will be doing game development and other shenanigans further down the line.
And Eli! Eli, where's your stream?
Man, come on. Look, I'm way too lame to stream. I have like no viewers. It'd be terrible.
I'd watch you stream.
It'd just be me like sitting in Discord and doing customer support and like
customer support for who, Eli?
For Game Wisp.
Oh, what is Game Wisp, Eli?
It's a way for streamers to monetize their fans.
Oh, you mean
like monthly recurring subscriptions?
You mean like subscribers?
Subscribers,
not subscribers, scrubscribers, motherfucker. This week we're launching our second monthly Discord party for scrubscribers.
How's that going? And
it's going awesome, actually.
Everybody's fucking slacking because nobody's telling me when they're goddamn available.
All right, so folks, everybody who's here. All right, we need you to tell Kajer what day this week you want that party to be going on. All right.
There's only like 2.5 left, so...
I know, right? Well, I mean, between today and the last day of the month. All right. So be certain to hit that up and tell Kajer when you want that happening. If not, we'll just... What was the last time? Was it Thursday night? We can't run it Thursday night.
It was Friday night last time.
It was Friday night? Oh, my God. I'm gonna be hungover and then drinking that night. That's going to be fucking awful. I'm gonna hate my life like a real Scotsman. And then Nerd Immersion! Who are you? And where can they find you? And what do you do?
Well, my name is Ted, but I have my channel Nerd Immersion, which is twitch.tv/nerdimmersion, and then every other social media that you can think of. And yeah, I stream Tuesday nights. At the current, might be adding more to that in the future if I get my shit together, which there's no guarantee. But a couple weeks, about 3-4 weeks back, the ongoing campaign for 53 weeks out of the past year, so I guess over a year, I TPK'd the whole party. So we just ended that campaign and started a new one. Because I said I don't want to make new characters. So while I'm designing a whole homebrew one, one of the guys that I play with is now running Out of the Abyss, and we just started that last week, so we're going to play through that while I design the homebrew in the background.
I'm running Out of the Abyss every Saturday on this channel at 4 p.m. EST. It's only vaguely resembles what the campaign book says it should be, because at this point we've got a subplot where the gods are manipulating the party, and one of us has been turned into a vampire, and there are arguments about whether or not he should be turning everybody who dies into a vampire. Like, it's pretty awesome. We had a character who started off as a tiefling wild mage sorcerer, who is now a human wild mage cleric, not because his character died, but because the gods interfered and said, you know what, fuck off, here you go. But all of that said, all right, we have wasted enough time on this intro, and if you're watching Mystic, hi Mystic, please be certain to do that magic that you always do with the clickities that you can put on the screen on YouTube, so that people don't have to listen to this shit on YouTube. And this is the part where I realized
I can never avoid hearing this shit, but, you know, somebody should.
Right, like, this is where I do that thing I do where I forgot to open the document. I need to read this out. This is the first time in, like, 2 weeks I've gotten to read this, guys! And thus our adventure begins.
Me. In the world of ages past, long ago, giants enslaved all the races of the earth. Even the mythical dragons and the gods were bound by them. Each of the races' respective gods were unwilling taskmasters, slave-driving goblinoids and men as the giants wished. The gods themselves were taskmastered by Abaddon and Metatron, brothers and fathers of all godkind. The brothers loved nothing more than one another, and the giants held each hostage, threatening each with the murder of the other in order to make them keep everyone in line. This changed when one man, an elf, whose slave name was Garnash, stole the first bits of magic for his kin. He mastered it in secret, becoming the most terrible wizard ever to have existed. His was a dark and sinister mind, consumed by hatred for the giants and dragons who enslaved all the realm. He stopped at nothing with his black magic to bring the race of giants to their knees and overthrew them, casting them from the world with a ritual that cost Metatron his life. This sent Abaddon into a frenzy of madness, but what was done could not be undone. The giants... The scroll wheel had gone way too fucking far there. Holy crap. The giants had fallen, men and goblinoids were free, and Metatron was no more. Without the kindness of Metatron to temper him, Abaddon's hatred and thirst for vengeance against all who lived consumed him. He was driven insane, irrevocably evil. And as the most powerful of all the gods, it was his malice which tainted the world, making it demonic and rife with undead, curses, witches, and worse. It is said that his first victims were the elves, which is why they exist no longer. The game of Everdeep doesn't have an expansive, huge campaign world. It has a single village, Everdeep, neighbored to a single adventure site, Everdeep Manor. The manor is thought to have been the giant king's mansion, later overtaken by the great wizard and used for centuries as his tower, laboratory, and library. Nobody knows how many levels deep the manor digs into the earth, or if it indeed ever ceases descending. It is thought to be the source of all malice in the world, as minor evils constantly lurk on its surface, bubbling up from beneath, driven upward by darker, more horrible things that lair within the deeper levels of the dungeon. The village is small, though the Templar and the Arcane Circle both have an interest in the manor, the former seeking information on the true fate of Metatron, the latter seeking the mystical knowledge of the Great Wizard. This interest in territorial competition means that mercenaries often find themselves hired to delve into the manor. Only the mad, the desperate, or the stupid come here hoping to make a fortune or carve a name for themselves. Thankfully, in a world without Metatron, there is an abundance of all three of those kinds of people. Speaking of which... you know the rules, Hawthorne. The regulars go first, and then we go around to the guests, and then the new characters go last. So, Hawthorne, you're up first. That means you're up first. Alright, so, race, class... Alignment?
It's been so long.
I know, like, right?
Sitting there right now, I'm going, shit.
Remind me, I've forgotten what your race, class, and alignment are.
So my race is human. My class is Bloodhunter, Order of the Lycan, Persuasion, and my alignment is Lawful Neutral.
For those of you who are just tuning in for the first time, yes, that is Bloodhunter, the class written by Matt Mercer, with, yes, the additional options written as the Unearthed Arcana release for... So we've got homebrew for our homebrew for our homebrew. Thank you, Matt. Mercer. Alright, what is your personality and your madness?
He actually has two personality traits. One is that he likes everything in its place, everything in its time. Organization, cleanliness, and calm thinking. There's no need to panic. And secondly, he has the soul of the giant. He has a... Well, there is an eye somewhere up in his person, which you can't see until he turns. The eye is exerting influence over him, and it would not tolerate the insolence of the slave races. His madness is that of obsession. What would Mother think if I did this or that? What would she say? I wonder what she would look like in that painting.
And your ever the longer growing encyclopedia of a backstory.
I'm sorry.
You're sorry. I'm sorry. I wrote the damn thing. And this is the trimmed version. All right. Let's do this.
Let's try and... Hawthorn.
There you go.
I was born a noble son. I had it made. Money, women, wine, food, clothes. I never knew my mother. She was slain by a lycanthrope only days after I was born. I idolized her. I practically worshipped the stories they told me about her. Beautiful, blonde, smart. Perfect. I studied the arts of blood magic as a young child, keeping my practices secret from my family. Sacrifices of local pets or other people's family heirlooms weren't all that bad, considering the other possibilities. All I needed was a chance to learn to bring back the dead. I started small. Patience is a virtue. I would often go to my mother's grave when no one was looking and cry angrily at the life I could have lived, a life with her. I practiced my magic there in the comfort of her presence when my mind was clear. I'd been working on a rite that would let me contact mother, and that night I was making my one and only attempt at performing it. The sacrifice the demons desired for this act of magic was something I had but could not replicate. I was interrupted by a werewolf, the very beast that had taken my mother from me. I don't remember much about that night. All I know is that in that struggle, I was bitten, and the dark magics I unleashed scared the werewolf away. It was too late. I was one of them. I was one of the monsters. I tracked that monstrosity down to Everdeep Manor. I will hunt it and I will kill it. It took my mother from me and it took away my only chance to talk to her after that. I don't care that it took away my chances at living a normal noble's life. I want it dead. Finding the bugger is turning out to be a hell of a ride, though. Lost my eye. Got a giant's eye in its place. Now it's starting to make me think things. I don't like those things. Mother wouldn't approve of those things. I could go on about my many manner misadventures. I'll keep it short. I did battle with the mad scientist, Giantess Ava. I've collected the corpse of an elf from the manor. I was there when Ganax, Demon King, was summoned to the mortal plane. I've done combat with actual giants trapped in hell. I was present for the rise of the Huanti from their banishment to the Neverworld. I saw the rise of the Phoenix firsthand. Mother would be proud.
Yeah, I tried to kill your fucking ass, but it didn't work.
The world is changing. Something. It's coming. Something big. And I don't care, because none of it matters without her. And I'm out.
All right.
You see, I agree something big is coming. I think it's a dragon, because you let it out!
Add it to the... Well, it's on the list. It's fine.
All right, so so we're going to go with Ted. Nerd immersion.
Yes.
What is your race, your class, and your alignment?
Oh, boy. You guys ready for this? I am playing Damien. Damien is an Azimar paladin who is chaotic good.
All right. What is your personality and your madness?
My personality is I love... Well, I like what I'm interpreting it as love. Prayers and proverbs. And my madness, just what you want in a paladin with lay on hands. He believes that he suffers from incurable leprosy and thinks that anyone is at a risk if he touches them or is too close to him or stands adjacent to him. So, you know...
The prayers and proverbs thing is going to be majestic this session.
Oh my god! Okay, so what about your backstory?
Oh boy. Alright. Well, I come from a long line of people. Forgot their duty. My great-granddaddy, he's a fool. He was the latest in an honorable line of warriors. His sole purpose was to guard the secret of the location of Everdeep Manor so that nobody... would ever know of its location or explore its power. He was trained to wait outside its doors, never go inside, and to slay anything left. He served his purpose, just as his pappy before him and his pappy before him and so on and so on. Everything should have been fine. Selena, the human god, smiled on our family. She gave us strength, protected us. Then, well, Grandpappy betrayed all of us. Did something stupid. Went and fell in love. The ghost of an insane mad scientist. A giantess named Ava. He did not pass the family tradition down the line. He corrupted our honor and our name. He failed in his duty to keep the manor secret. Everdeep was discovered. I found my grandpappy's diaries in the attic of that building that you call the Blood of Beard. And since I cannot guard the manor from the world, I suppose I should do the next best thing. Strike the manor down once. And for all.
And I believe that brings us around to Kajer. Oh, no, wait.
I just got to say, as a native Southerner, I'm very impressed with that.
you will be continuously less and less impressed with Damien as time goes by, is my assumption.
Have you watched Judah Steer just out of curiosity?
I've seen it show up. I haven't. I got to confess.
No, I was commenting to Eli because he was complimenting your accent.
It's a rule in Judas Steer, which we stream on Fridays on this channel every Friday at 10 p.m. EST.
Shameless
AM.
Fuck.
AM. The AM. AM. 10 a.m. Did I say 10 p.m.? 10 a.m. EST. The rule of Deadlands is that it's not a real cowboy game unless you are using your worst southern accent entire show. To the point where it's all natural now. Just bust out that damn southern accent. It makes absolutely no resemblance to the real thing at all.
I mean, like, get a couple drinks in me and I don't even have to fake it.
Alright, so Eli, you'll be playing Bruce. Yes, what is your race, class, and alignment?
Let me pull it up here. I was so distracted by that eloquent southern charm. So yeah, I'm an Asimar as well. Chaotic good, rogue, currently level 5, and my background is vigilante. So
what about
I'm
your
also,
personality and madness?
Yeah, getting there.
Yeah.
I am a real freak for Metatron. I got a real deity boner for that guy. I love the temple and the Templar. They give me purpose. And my madness is that Metatron is everywhere. I'm certain of it. His spirit speaks to me through signs and omens guiding my actions. In reality, I'm seeing nothing more than coincidence. It's just what I want to see. I impose meaning on the mundane. I mean, call it what you want. It's the inner workings of the great and majestic Metatron. All right. So do you need background as well?
Yes.
Okay. Mine's much shorter than others. So... I don't think I can do the character voice, guys. It's just too deep. Anyway, I was born into money in a city so corrupt. It was the kind of town where the local brewing clan of dwarves had struck a deal with the Thieves Guild that landed a lot of innocent people in jail. Not a nice place. My parents were gunned down in an alleyway by a random mugger one night on the way home from Temple. I didn't handle this well if it weren't for Alfred, the family caretaker. I've probably been broken and shattered. Alfred was particularly religious, and even though the loss of my parents broke my mind a little, he helped me find stability in the Temple. By the time I was a teenager, I'd heard my first word from the great and mighty Metatron. The world was filled with cruelty and murder and victims who never got any justice, like me and my parents. Through signs and omens, Metatron told me I was to be his vengeance, his blade in the dark. So I trained, and I set off. And there's nowhere in the world where victims need closure more than they need it in Everdeep. So here I am. There you go.
You should be ashamed! Ashamed!
What's the matter, Chris? You didn't like Alfred, really?
No, Alfred, I didn't. Man. I didn't like Alfred.
Alfred. Alfred was awesome. Don't judge me. I have to write a new backstory for every character that comes through, and that's not just counting all of the guests we have in the show. That's counting all the time everybody dies. I have to have a new backstory. Pyro's current character. His character's name is Deja Vu spelt backwards, and his backstory is the same backstory his last character had, with some slight differences to indicate that maybe his character's being manufactured until it succeeds.
You know, it's a lot of hard work, man.
I know how many character sheets or how many backstories you have to write, because I build the characters when they die.
All right, so,
Missing just got onto the Batman.
Metatron Man.
Metatron Man. The Batatron.
Metaband.
Alright, so, today there is one other character. Asclepius. Is a Yuan-T wise man. He is among the strongest of the wise men, but also the least combatively powerful of the wise men. And Asclepius walks in the footsteps of Set, the grandfather of all living Yuan-T. However, while he will be our quest giver and possibly our escort, again, noting, of course, that our group, our table, has exactly 0% of any escort quests being completed.
Surviving an escort counts.
Not if the escort doesn't survive.
Does protecting the angel count?
No. I'm gonna say yes. That's totally.
He's like, yeah, of course it does. Fuck you.
There was that one episode where all you had to do was win a fight. I'm not counting that. You know why? Because I was drunk that day and I forgot like half of the things that were supposed to be preventing you from hurting monsters. So I'm not counting that one. That one wasn't fair.
Still counts.
I should get a point because I killed the last escort in the last escort quest.
All right, so, Kajer, name, yes. Race, class, and alignment.
I am Leviathan. I am a Yuan-T, lawful neutral, and a druid.
What is your personality and your madness?
I have a hard time processing metaphors, figures of speech, and similar lingual conundrums. I try to use them, but it rarely goes well. As far as madness is concerned, I have a hard time taking captives. Brutality is a release, not a problem.
And your backstory.
I hatched with the knowledge that sacrifices had to be made if the Yuan-T are going to survive. The world is so much more harsh than it was when my egg was created, and nothing comes for free. I helped set up the Yuan-T encampment under Seth's guiding hand. The elder Yuan-T was as close to a father figure as we snake people can have. And the moment the phoenix tore him to shreds, all the Yuan-T could feel it, no matter which side of hell we were on. And in that moment, I knew two things. One, there is no greater power than hate. And two, Seth's sacrifice taught me that. I will not let his sacrifice go in vain. I will kill Phoenix.
All right. So, with our heroes assembled, as a quick rundown, the next step is we are hitting the vendors. So, if you're unfamiliar with how I do the vendors, I run these kind of like Skyrim vendors in the sense that I keep persistent inventories for each vendor between adventures. If the adventurers from one game actually sell an item to the vendors, it might be available for purchase in the next adventure for the next PCs. Sometimes the vendors will... Sometimes the vendors will acquire magical items from NPC mercenaries that are having their own missions, or sometimes NPC mercenaries will buy those items. They have running totals of coins. Each player is allowed to steal from the vendors once per adventure. Steal, swindle, or otherwise be an asshole to. Simply doing so will earn you bad karma. We'll talk about karma in a little bit, though. So, who wants to go first on the vendoring? Anybody have something they want to buy, sell, coins to spend, anything?
I have no idea. I have to look.
You have 50 coins to start with.
We have no potions at the Arcane Circle?
There are no personal potions or scrolls. There is a Shield of Faith.
Just looking, there is...
Is that an actual shield?
Yes. It is, however, 250 coins, unless you wanted to steal it.
What the fuck was that? It's like I was trying to be a snake person, and then I remembered there was a word that I was supposed to say.
I'm going to sell the Hades ammo pouch.
Okay, you're going to sell the Hades ammo pouch. Did you steal the Hades ammo pouch?
I stole it back.
Yes, okay, so that will count as your swindling.
Wait, what?
To prevent players from being able to infinitely loop magic items back and forth, every episode, we instituted a rule where if you sell an item to a vendor that you stole, that counts as your swindling attempt and will give you the bad karma. But you will get that.
You're selling it to a different vendor.
Yes.
I tried that too.
Zang, you wouldn't let me Zang, do
it.
Zang.
Hang on. Then I'm not going to do it.
Okay.
It's fine. I'm not going to do it.
I'm going to institute this rule to prevent this abuse. What about this obvious loophole that will enable this abuse?
Goddamn. Well, I'm out. unless I can buy something for 4 coins, I think I'm out.
You don't want to swindle somebody?
No. I already have 3 bad karma. My whole thing was to reduce my karma level.
What a bitch! 3 bad karma. Get the fuck off this.
Cher had. Didn't your last character have like 21 bad karma when you went out?
I think so. Hold on, I can check.
Anybody else want to do any vendoring?
Yeah. Actually, I'm just curious. I see this because the Yuan-T camp was at the end, like it showed up at the end of the last time I played. So that's the whole thing to me.
Yeah.
And I'm looking at this silver precious metal adamantine thing.
Okay, so it's not actually silver. It's me being an idiot. The precious metal for this adventure is adamantine. It turns out that the Yuan-T are, in and of themselves, they have a very ancient tradition of metallurgy and blacksmithing with mystical metals and precious metals and rare substances. And so you can get a weapon coated in this for 100 coins if you want. It changes from adventure to adventure. There's like fucking eight or nine of them.
Okay, and that, but that's like, it's not like a limited use, then my weapon is that then going
correct
forward. You know what? Yeah, that dire metal seems kind of shiny, so.
All right, so you're going to spend 100 coins at the UNT camp.
Yeah.
Vendoring, by the way, happens over by, I don't know, the fucking vendors, so I should probably put the camera over here where you can see the vendors. All right, so you're giving 100 coins to the UNT camp. Please knock yourself down 100 coins. Who wants to go? Does anybody else want anything?
I want to... if the Bloody Beard does have adventuring gear, I have none, so...
I think the Bloody Beard currently has two adventuring gear.
I will buy both of those if nobody else wants them, because I have none, so...
All right.
Oh, you go for it, dude. I'm good.
So that's what? That's 5 coins each, right?
Yeah, so...
Saying you can't actually afford adventuring gear. You're 4
coins. Myself down to
7. I have 2.
Adventuring gear has, we went through over the course of like 8 or 9 adventures where healing potions of any kind and adventuring gear of any kind were just, it was a drought. There was just nothing. And so there's been this story building where Nozzle, the goblin who works at the Arcane Tents, the Arcane Circle Tents, has just been hoarding it all because he's petrified because he summoned Ganax, who turned out to be Mojo.
Right, which I recall, but then I left, so it didn't matter.
Right.
Because I could sense that he was a demon, but I didn't do anything with it.
All right, so, any other vendoring anybody wants to do?
I think I will actually take the Songs of War from my people.
You are going to buy them?
Yes.
All right, how many coins is that?
All of them.
50 coins? All right, so Songs of War is, it's basically 3 charges of Bardic Inspiration at a D6 bonus.
Mm-hmm.
And you can spend those at any time over the course of the adventure to add D6 to your roll. That happens after you roll, but before you know what the result of the roll is going to be. This is the perfect opportunity for me to point out that there is there have been 2 changes to the unnatural dice system. If somebody buys you a whole bunch of crits or botches, you can compile them all from the same donator into a mega britch or ultra crutch. Mega
crits. What is with you in the ultra crutch?
I have no idea.
goddamn time.
Mega crits and ultra botches. And also there are twists of fate now. If you donate $4, you can get a twist of fate. Those are just like unnatural crits and unnatural botches, except for we don't know which it's going to be until it comes up. All right. On top of that, if you want information more about the unnatural dice system and how you can grab a player by the beard and just tug, because I think everybody on screen right now has a beard. Men? Beards? Yes. Beards? A beard stroking session, Cammy? Can we have a beard stroking session? If you too would like to stroke these beards, then all you have to do is donate, and we will reward you with unnatural beard dice.
$1.99 a minute. You too could stroke.
All right, so today's adventure premise is actually rather simple. There is a UNT. He is a good friend of yours, Leviathan, by the name of Asclepius, and Asclepius is a healing guru. That's kind of his gig. His magic takes a long time and special ingredients and things that are required at the UNT camp, so he won't actually be able to heal you in the adventure. Beyond that, he affords non-mercenaries a lot of special care. and this is how you're like, yes, he's a healer. No, I didn't add any special healing available to you. Fuck off. He has, there is a body of a woman, he fears it is a body at this point. Many, many days ago, he hired a mercenary group to track this person into the manor. You see, there is a cult growing inside the manor. There were many UNT in Everdeep before the Great Awakening, where Hawthorne and his companions actually hatched many eggs and freed an entire new race onto the face of the earth. Before that, there were UNT, but they had all been driven mad by the manor, and they had just, you know, decayed and devolved over time. With this resurgence of the UNT, they have found new intelligent leadership under Imhotep. who's a powerful sorcerer, a powerful wizard, some kind of arcane spellcaster. And Imhotep worships Phoenix. And so the Imhotep and his armies of blue Yuan-Ti that exist within the manor have started infiltrating members of the Yuan-Ti camp. And he and Asclepius, as the wise man of the tribe now, had sent this up-and-coming Yuan-Ti as a spy to go and infiltrate. He has not heard from her, as he was supposed to, so he assumes she is dead. As a result of this, he has decided that it is only right that the Yuan-Ti enter the manor and reclaim the body before any profane phoenix rites can be applied to bring her back from the dead as some cursed, flaming ex-Yuan-Ti.
Why do we not kill all of them? The Yuan-Ti.
That would be a secondary objective. However, the cult is prolific and holds up primarily in the manor, making extermination rather difficult. But that is something that we would very much like to do.
Is it possible that I could make these Yuan-Ti see the light of the Lord and Savior Metatron and leave the evil Phoenix?
I like that look. Unlikely, but you are welcome to try.
I think we just have to kill them all.
You can go ahead and take your Metatron obsession as inspiration at the start of the session.
You got to get that inspiration early. You never know when you might need it.
A fucking man. So, with all the vendoring done, you guys have been hired again. Hawthorne, you will notice that you are part of the group that Asclepius has assembled. After his comments at the last group, you see, the problem is that this was the same mission that was assigned to the last table of people that we played with, and they spent a full hour and a half trying to get past a hole in the ground, and then almost died to a accidentally summoned unicorn.
Okay, it wasn't just any hole in the ground. You make it sound pathetic. Like,
that's because it was pathetic.
You had an undead unicorn. There was a fucking... The whole room was full of wild magic surge-causing bullshit, so no spells could be used. We were stuck in somewhere... I can't even remember what the fucking orb did, other than be immune to everything. And the pit was full of fucking acid! And they were trying to make you fall into fucking pit.
I watched the world's worst decisions be made for, like, an hour and a half. It was pretty funny.
I thought he was gonna say, it wasn't just any unicorn, okay? It was Victor Sunshine.
Right?
But Asclepius had made comments as to the incompetence of that group of mercenaries and decided he would come back with people he could actually trust to not suck. And you will notice that Hawthorne, you were among that group of people that he said that he has decided he can trust to not suck.
I think my decision was about the only one that made sense at the beginning of that whole...
We had heavily armored clerics going, what's that? A rickety thin bridge that can barely hold up an elf's weight? I know. Clomp, clomp, clomp. Like, it was ridiculous. Yeah. It was so bad. So, as today's adventure begins, you as a group find yourself walking up the, at this point, very familiar, long and winding path that kind of meanders along the absolutely sheer and lifeless cliff face that crests up at the top of the cliff and breaks into the forest that has been dead since before you were born, and it is home to this giant, gargantuan, oversized mansion. It is a mansion sized for creatures that are 15 to 20 feet tall on average. These massive doors that are always made of something different every time you come up. This time they are made of clay and stone with silver engravings of various runes and giantish phrases. And as you approach, they gently open the clay of the doors scraping along the bottom of the floorboards, causing this very unsettling scratching sound. And inside the manor is dark. Asclepius will motion in and explain that he knows the way, as does Hawthorne, and the two of them will begin to lead you down into the depths of the second floor of the manor. And thus begins our adventure today. Will the PCs be able to overcome the holes in the ground? Will the PCs be able to discover the fate of Asclepius' spy? And who dies today? Will Kajer die on his first adventure as Leviathan? All these questions and more shall know the answers by the end of today's episode. I'm Evil Squeegee, I'll be your DM. This is Zang Mac, Nerd Immersion, Eli Hooten, and Kajer playing Dungeons & Dragons 5th Edition. Welcome to Everdeep, motherfuckers, and intro! And today, I have terrible news during the intro, guys. During the intro,
first player death.
We had our first player death, not our first PC death. Our first player death. Eli Hooten is dead. He had. Oh my God, he's not.
Oh my God,
he's not actually dead. Holy shit, it's a revenant. Run!
I fell in the hole, but I climbed out.
Oh, okay. I thought you were dead. I was just telling everybody we had our first actual player death.
Yeah, like real life. It was
like,
crazy.
Like it was
I know that struggle, dude.
There was a unicorn. It was tough.
The fucking unicorn. All right, so marching order, boys and girls. What would you like to be doing here? As Asclepius and Hawthorne take you down the very simple path leading into the second floor of the dungeon, the basement of the manor itself, the colorful and bright marble and stone floors of the first floor, and the constant, distant, echoing buzz and hum of ancient elven technology give way to the dead silence, broken only by the occasional drip of a long-forgotten basement with rough-hewn, scratchy floors and giant uncomfortable steps. As you're going down the stairs, remember, this is a staircase made for giants, meaning that each of these steps is a 5-foot chunk of stone, and you actually have to lower yourself down. What I want to know is, who lights the torch?
Did you say that the escort guy is basically fuck useless for anything other than to be another target?
Basically, yes. However, I will say,
he can carry the fucking torch.
Since he is hiring you to go in, since he's hiring you guys to go in, he will, you guys can tell me where you want him to be standing.
Okay, I'd like him to light a torch.
But he doesn't have any equipment. If he did, he might have done this on his own. Who's lighting the torch? He'll carry it.
Do I have a torch? That's a good question.
Do you have adventuring gear?
Yeah.
I think somebody bought it all.
Yeah.
I didn't get it.
That's fine. I'll light a torch.
All right, and you'll hand it to Asclepius. All right, so Asclepius will get a torch. That'll be a 30-foot light radius here. Pow! All right, so as you guys are stepping down here, there is, the first thing is you guys finally reach the bottom of the staircase, right? There is, yet again, for the third time, Hawthorne, you're encountering this very powerful looking set of magical runes that are engraved in the floor. They give off a sparkling blue light, and from these arcane circles grow these blue shining mushrooms. The light doesn't seem to pierce the darkness at all, but it does cast everything in a muted hue. Now Leviathan and Hawthorne, Leviathan being capable of reading Yuan-T, you recognize these runes. These runes are, they are designed such that anybody who crosses through crosses this threshold will... the magic will harm them, but only if they have spilled the blood of a Yuan-T. You can only assume that the cult has erected this barrier. It also seems to be, like, worked into and overlaid with another magical effect that seems to ban powerful undead, such as Ava, from crossing its threshold.
And stop us summoning an undead unicorn, though. Fucking put waste of space barrier bullshit.
Gear Jammer 29, $40 says two crits for Zhang, along with two botches for Zhang. One crit for the others, three and one botch for Squeegee.
Who's on the sheet today? Do we have one of the other mods on this?
I suppose. I don't know. Pyromancy, I think, is doing dice today. He can yell at me if I'm wrong. That reminds me. Okay. Can you supply the link to everybody so that we can all be on top of this?
It's in Zoom chat.
All right, good. All right, so.
You said it was any Yuan-T, right?
Having spilled the blood of any Yuan-T. Yes.
So it doesn't care about color, then.
Correct. So, Leviathan. Have you spilled the blood of a Yuan-T?
Well, this is my first time back in the manor.
Have you spilled your own blood?
Probably not. So you can cross freely.
It's hard to get blood from a rock.
And everybody stops, pauses, and goes... What? And you get inspiration for playing out your personality. So Asclepius can and will cross. Leviathan, you can cross as well. Now, Hawthorne.
The thing is, Asclepius has killed. This was part of the problem. Asclepius had killed... So this was part of the problem that we had before, was that the fucking escort has already done damage and could potentially die from the first barrier. So this is part of the ha ha ha, you guys fucked up and fell into a hole. No, we had this bullshit to deal with as well. So welcome to my hell, guys.
Alright, so Asclepius will wait to go by. Damien, have you ever killed a snake person?
Probably not. No, I mean you keep saying Yuan-T. I don't even know what that is.
Yuan-T is a snake person.
Oh, I mean, I know. Ted knows, but Damien don't know what that is.
Out of character. No, you haven't. But Bruce did on his very first adventure. He was among the very first of any mercenaries to actually harm a Yuan-T.
Does it count if they were infidels?
Yes. Unfortunately. It counts if they're mad as fuck and needed put down like a rabid dog as well. Yeah.
I'm just gonna take this as a sign that Metatron doesn't want me in here because I was doing his holy duty. Just slaying those infidelious Yuan-T.
So Hawthorne, do you wanna do anything? Maybe roll Arcana to see where you should smudge this thing to give people crossing advantage.
Asclepius and I last time managed to do something to the barrier that diffused it temporarily because it was blood magic and close to, like, basically he had the understanding of the Yuan-T aspect of it and it was close to my blood magic.
Yep.
So
what if I just believe hard enough that my god will protect me? Is there a dice I can roll for that?
Yes. Yes, there is. Is that what you would like to do, Bruce?
Maybe. Yes.
I'm filled
with the saving grace of Metatron, who will provide a shield around me to cross his barrier.
I want you to make a wisdom saving throw.
Except he crits, thanks to Gear Jammer.
and I do crit.
And as such... I will allow you to bring either Hawthorne or Asclepius across the barrier with you as a result of that crit.
So I turn around and look back at the barrier, and I say, how do you feel about your Lord and Savior, Metatron? Feel free to answer.
Frankly, I couldn't give a fuck.
I don't understand your hesitation.
Well, fine.
Asclepius shrugs.
Okay. All right. Come on. Well, come on through, Hawthorne. I feel like
No. Take.
Can you get through? Sons?
Take the NPC. Take the NPC.
Oh, but he's a snake man. Come on, Asclepius.
Yeah. He's got like 5 hit points. So take the
fucking snake. So Asclepius carrying the torch will nod and through the power of Bruce's belief and faith in his deity, as Asclepius walks past, right? Like the energies will arc up and try and strike him down as he crosses the threshold. But Metatron, or more technically, Metatron's essence, his being, what little of Metatron's energies that exist in the world will shield him, and those little arcing blue, like baby sky blue lightning arcs that try and like pop up off the ground and like tear him down will just meet little white rippling discs of light as he crosses over and is ultimately fine.
So as the Asclepius comes through, I look at him and say, just because my God chose to protect you doesn't mean I think you're any more useful.
Asclepius will nod and he says,
if I was useful down here, I would have no need to pay you.
Know your place, snake man.
Sorry. Come on, Billy, club him in the back of the head.
Blap! Know your place, snake man, he says, as he's literally standing between two snake men. all right, and Hawthorne, what do you want to do?
Okay, I'm going to basically try... we did this before. I'm going to try to do the temporary bypass, and I'm going to try and do it without Asclepius' help, because he's already on the other side.
All right, so
it's going to be a ritual of blood magic to temporarily allow people to bypass.
Roll me Arcana.
I crit, thanks to Gear Gemma 29.
All right, on a crit, I will let you pass without even needing to save. Normally, that ritual would give you advantage, but on a nat 20, or an un-nat 20, as the case may be, I will let you go through unharmed. Now, as Asclepius steps forward here, the torchlight illuminates these posts. There are these, to the north and south of this tunnel, there are these banners of like plain blue cloth with a simplistic Yuan Ti symbol on them. You recognize that as the symbol for Phoenix Leviathan. And these, both of these banners have been previously burned. The posts that they're on are charred and obviously, you know, have been victims of fire. There's scorch marks all over the floor, but the banners have since been replaced.
So we'll have to do something about that. I will take the torch and I will burn them again.
Bruce applauds.
All right. Somehow I don't have this already prepared. Just give me... How do I not have this prepared? I know what I'm doing. I swear. This is gonna be... Okay, this is gonna be like... Eh.
Have those statues moved again? Or am I just imagining things?
They have been reallocated their directions, yes. So Leviathan will be leaning down and setting each of these banners on fire. Mortar brings up a very good point. How I don't know why I'm not prepared for this, because every adventuring party that comes through here has set those banners on fire. And the UNT keep fixing them, and then the PCs keep setting them on fire again. But yes, last time you came through here, these statues had all been altered. Like, they had been rotated differently. And this time they are different even yet again. So as the crackling fire of the burning banners, Bruce, illuminate the room, you can see that there used to be some sort of mystical small platform that came a couple inches up off the ground, square in shape, with an arcane circle around it. Used to be here, has since been smashed.
Who smashed this room? What happened here? Last time I was here, there was an intricate, if not overly contrived, puzzle involving rotating statues.
It kind of was like this one time when we came down here. I think it was the mad snakes, not these ones. These ones seem all right.
These less mad snakes.
These ones I kind of helped hatch. I'm not sure. Maybe.
You helped these snake people hatch and come to being, and they still wouldn't let you through their blue door.
That's
their state priorities, man.
Don't I know it?
You would mistake us for the blue.
Look, scales are scales, bro. It's all the same to me.
So is flesh.
So what are we doing here? What happens next?
Scales is flesh. That don't make no sense.
Scales is flesh.
It's like, I got flesh, and you got scales, and that make no...
This is where Nerdimers looks at the sheet and says, int 12? Nah, that should say 4. Like... And on that note, as you guys turning down this ever familiar looking pit trap, we're gonna take our top of the hour break because it's 11:01. So 3 to 5 minute break here, guys. We'll be right back after these messages. Who can man the guns?
Where does the time go?
Welcome back to twitch.tv/evilsquidgy. If you are tuning in on YouTube, you're probably going, that wasn't an hour at all. It's because I ran my mouth forever and ever and ever at the start of this show. So let's get to this. The party has just made it past the first of the challenges, a set of magical runes that are there only to harm those who have spilled the blood of UNT, which is almost everybody, basically. And as you guys are looking down the hallway, right, you've got the light shed by little tiny bits of, glowing, luminescent mushrooms, barely giving you some clues to what lies down the hallway. Now, Hawthorne, you've had some experience with this specific trap before, and you are aware, because of your previous adventures in this exact hallway, that the UNT that inhabit this tunnel like to screw with this trap, so it's different every time. Last time, there was a panel here of floorboards that pulled into the side of the wall as soon as you crossed halfway through.
Mm-hmm.
And then the second time you came through, the trigger point had changed, so it was the first square, not the second square, of the floor that set it off. Meanwhile, there was this bridge that was thin enough that only the UNT could pass over it safely. You may notice it has not been repaired since the heavily armored cleric decided to clomp across the bridge last time you guys were here. The water here is no longer acid like it was last time. It appears to just be filthy water with bits of various, mushroom stems and things floating in it. So, what would you guys like to do confronted with this pit? Knowing that you can't expect anything that you've expected before.
Can I take a closer look at the water?
You can. The water is 30 feet down, all right? So you can kind of, look over the edge. Give me a perception roll.
Okay. Just a second. I was unprepared to do that.
Does he crit?
Say what?
Does he crit?
No unnatural.
Okay, there's no unnatural dice. All right, so, go ahead and click the word perception.
Yeah. I didn't have my character sheet up. There you go.
On a 10, those mushrooms look like they were cut. They don't look like they just, like, floated up from the bottom or whatever. Ooh. Like,
you know, we got an unnatural stew going on here.
Yeah.
Is there any heat coming up? Is it warm?
Not particularly, no.
Okay.
Does it look like mushrooms that we've encountered before?
Yes. All kinds.
Oh, so it's some concoction of shrooms.
Yeah.
Okay.
So what Hawthorne is referencing there is in previous adventures in Everdeep, they've encountered a great many number of species of mushrooms, and consuming those mushrooms has generally done usually bad, but sometimes good things. There were the mushrooms that made you grow big or small. There were the mushrooms that caused you to be fortunate, which we haven't discovered the actual meaning of yet. There were mushrooms that just dealt damage to you. There were mushrooms that gave you extra sight. There were mushrooms that did all kinds of things.
How like, long is this pit? Is it possible to do, like, just a crazy jump over it, or is it way too long?
Okay, so it's 20 feet across.
But it's, like, 25 on your dex roll or some bullshit.
Yeah, it's okay. To get from one side to the other side is 25 feet, and the way that I've called it is that 1 for 1 feet on the jump. Technically, by the rules of 5th edition, you should have a set number of feet that you can jump for free, and I said, fuck it. So, trying to jump across this pit would be very difficult. Possible, yeah, but you would have to roll really well.
Does it stretch wall to wall? Can you, like, clamber across any sidewalls or anything?
It is wall to wall. It used to be a pit trap,
okay,
that was meant to catch anybody going through the hallway.
Mm-hmm.
But in the ages since its construction, the floor kind of crumbled, fell apart. The trap wasn't functional the first time you came through. The UNT have started to repair it, but it's been tripped. So
can I, if I could like grab onto a sidewall, could I sort of scale across it?
No.
Alright. Well,
so I will see these two studying this trap. And I will stare at them for a moment. I will say, what's the problem?
Shroom soup and there's no floor to go over.
I mean, I will look over at Asclepios. It's no wonder you've had to come in here again. And I will raise my arms, and from the end of one of my sleeves will come the head of a snake.
Mm-hmm.
And it will continue coming out of the robe, growing as it does so, until it occupies most of the hallway.
Where would you like me to place your huge-sized snake? Controlled by the DM, and... did you change your display name to Leviathan? You did. Excellent. Boom.
Bruce elbows Hawthorne and kind of looks at him and says under his breath, somebody's compensating for something, am I right?
I mean, I'm not seeing any equipment, so yeah.
I'm actually going to have it slither across the bridge.
Okay. So, as you go to send the snake to slither across the bridge, the bridge will be entirely insubstantial, and the snake will fall into the pit. The bridge is an illusion. The snake will fall into the water. This is a familiar, right?
No, this is a summoned animal.
All right, so this is a summoned animal. All right. So the snake will start, like, it'll hit the water, and it'll be startled for a second, and then it'll, like, calm down, and it'll just kind of, like, slither in the water for a second, and then it'll start to, like, hiss and snap at things that aren't there.
Damon's gonna look down and go, well, I don't know about y'all, but last time I was faced with some sort of pit, and he looks at some of the people and goes, they were magic people and they did all this stuff, but he goes, but what I did, I just jumped. And then everything was fine because I floated. So I can float. So I'm just going to run and jump over.
The worst part of this, you guys don't even know. All right, so Damien, give me a strength athletics check.
I believe I crit.
Oh, he does.
All right, okay.
Crit thanks to Gear Jam.
I'm going to tell you to hold that crit for a good reason. So don't spend that crit. Make this an all-natural check.
All right, so this is an athletics check? Or
yeah. Yeah, you get advantage if you take a 10-foot running jump.
Natural 20.
Oh shit!
All right. So
that's a 26 as well. That beats the 25 distance.
All right. So as it turns out here, Damien, right here, I'm gonna move. The snake is in the pit. I'm just gonna move it up here so I can drag it up.
Wait! Don't jump yet. Tie a rope around your waist.
All right. So as Bruce is like, wait, hold on, is like tying the rope like. Damien is just up and at him, right? And Damien, you're gonna jump. God. You're not gonna make it across the pit. However, you are a man of faith, are you not? Right? Yep. You are going to run and jump, and your belief in floating will be horribly reinforced because there is actually an invisible floor where you land over here, right? And so you're like, ah!
What about the snake, though?
See, y'all just gotta believe.
He fell in.
You just gotta believe that you can fly and float, and then just look.
So, you're telling me you believe you can fly?
I've done it before. One time. A.K.A. somebody cast Featherfall on me, and I just jumped.
This character had no idea that was the case.
No, I saw somebody else do it, so I figured I could do it too.
I've heard if you just believe it, there's nothing to it. So
that's right. You know.
Perhaps you might want to test your own faith.
So, I will command the snake to, spiral up.
All right, and you want on the other side?
Yes.
All right. So the snake like kind of like runs along one edge at an upward angle, right? Finding whatever cracks or little bits and pieces, sticks and stuff, it kind of like let its weight rest on. It'll kind of slither all the way around the edges of the pit until it climbs up and over. And you can see this massive, like this thing is as thick around as a tree trunk, right? As it kind of like slithers up and over the edge of the pit.
Oh, wait, how did he... Did you just go straight over that side?
I'm being carried by the snake. I'm going to just...
Oh, you were on the snake?
No, when it comes up, I'm going to step on it and just...
And just let it ride you across. How long does this summon last?
3 hours.
Ooh.
Hey, man, can I get one of them snake ferry rides?
Yeah, right.
I'm sorry. Did you say you wanted something from the scale people?
Yeah. Or the flesh people. The same thing, remember?
we're all one flesh, snake man.
If you could at least get Asclepius here over, that would be great.
I will send the snake back for it.
All right, so Asclepius is across. As Asclepius lands here, you may notice there is a very familiar-looking, oily, distorted mist on the air. Last time you were here, there was this sense that, like, magic in the area had been curdled, like milk, it had gone bad. And you could physically feel it in the air, and every time magic happened, there was a wild magic surge, and that thick blue and purple mist seems to have come back. Does anybody else? What is everybody else doing?
I'm gonna go over to the rubble and collect like a handful of like stones.
Yep.
And I'm gonna scatter them over the side of the pit trap that Damien's on.
Yep.
To see if any fall through. I'm basically trying to find out safe squares.
Okay, so anything except for the first row is safe. That is to say that whoever designed this pit trap decided, oh, they're gonna try and jump, right? They're gonna try the ladder, the bridge. Bridge is bad. So they're gonna try and jump. They're gonna jump and realize, oh yeah, safe place. So the next guy who walks through goes, okay, well, ah, and falls down that first 5 foot of invisible.
Okay. With that information in mind, I'm going to take a run and...
get a five on a check with advantage.
Yeah, I botched sense again.
Alright.
So, in...
yeah.
I will...
Who is this? Is this Gear Jammer?
Gear Jammer, yeah.
Will my snake be able to catch him before he falls in the water?
Not on a botch. However, your snake can collect him after he has suffered the consequences of his botch. If he had failed, I would have been like, yeah, the snake can make an attempt to catch him. All right, so Hawthorne, you are running. Notice all these all this rubble here.
Which rubble am I looking at? The rubble that I've just thrown everywhere?
Yeah. You notice how it's one of these things. You ever see somebody slip on a banana peel, right?
Yep.
There's a roly pebble, right? And it's not like you of all people, like you're not you've got a.
Oh, I'm a dexterous motherfucker.
You are acrobatic and dexterous, right? But clearly the gods hate you today. It's not your fault that there just so happened to be one pebble on top of the one little bit of wet stone there. That's probably only wet because the giant snake kind of rubbed past it, right? But the combination of things is just so that there's no way you could have predicted it. And instead of jumping, you're going to slip and you're going to go pull one of these and then fall head first down into the water below. Roll me acrobatics to see if you can take half damage from the fall.
I crit, thanks to Kit Chabba.
Alright, so you're gonna hit the water, you're gonna be like, ah, shit, and put...
Can I swan dive?
Yeah, you're gonna be like, right? Recover before you hit the ground, right? And everybody's kind of leaning in and be like, 7 out of 10, excellent, right? As you're hit the water, perfect, no damage. But then I need you to give me a charisma save.
Which I botched, thanks to Gear Jammer.
Seriously?
Yep.
For real?
For real, yep.
Okay, because that's going to be a Christmas save versus madness. All right,
I figured.
So madness incoming. All right, now, special rules about madness here. We use the madness rules as presented in the DMG. Specifically, I use the version of them presented in the Underdark book, Out of the Abyss. However, much like you can see somebody buying crits and botches to screw over or fuck with their favorite or least favorite players, you can also see people who will have destiny tokens, and that means they get to choose what madness pops out. What level's madness is this?
Short term. I cleared all my shit last time.
Okay, so this is madness level 1?
Oh. Yep.
Alright, Techie Mrs. $25 says, Gear Jammer, make jam your gears, but I'll oil your beard. One crit to each person on screen with a beard. That would be 25. Yes, 25. So it's one crit to everybody, since everybody has a beard.
So, should take two levels?
That's the Destiny token sound. Pyromancy. Alright, Pyro.
Should he take two levels for the boss?
Fuck you!
Oh yeah, that's true. That is what happens on a botch save. No, that's actually what happens on a botch save.
Does that bump up to a long mad then?
Yeah, it's a long mad. I only request that you not pick deafness. Because his character in our Saturday campaign has 2 hours left of deafness, but he's been deaf for
2 hours, sessions. 25 minutes. Yep.
Oh.
So that was Pyro.
Yeah, pyromancy is picking a long madness. So we just need to know what pyromancy wants to have happen to him as he is infected with madness from mushroom soup. And the only rule is it can't be deafened or blinded, so no 56 to 65. The Destiny Token lets pyromancy choose the number that is rolled, and I, as the GM, interpret how that happens. But it's just... I'm being nice, and I'm saying he can't deafen you, because I know that's exactly what he wants to do. That's what I would do, if that was allowed. Mm-hmm. I'd be like, deafness. Every character you ever rolled would just be deaf.
What? Can we make him a mute?
A 66 to 75. The character experiences uncontrolled tremors or tics, which impose disadvantage on attack rolls, ability checks, and saving throws that involve strength or dexterity.
You For have a long? Bit of a twitch.
Roll me D100. I'm sorry, D10.
D10.
Yeah. It'll be 50 hours. 50 hours.
Yeah. Yeah.
So a little over 2 days.
Rough.
All right, so Hawthorne sails down into the water, right? Sploosh. And your body just like starts shaking. As you can feel like you almost start to hallucinate, and it's like a heat wave and then a cold wave. Mm-hmm. And like your nerves are starting to freak out, and you're starting to feel things that don't exist. And your hands start to shake. And then there is suddenly a giant snake looking you in the eye like...
Somebody get that, please.
And, Immortal Circle, $10, says 2 botches for the DM.
Hey.
This might be your lucky day, guys. So Hawthorne will be dragged around by the snake. Damien, you can just walk across if you would like as well.
Yep, I'll just do that.
and Bruce, can you make a 5-foot jump?
I hope so.
You crit, thanks to Yumi.
I gotta blow the crit on a 5-foot jump?
I'm gonna say you don't have to blow the crit on a 5-foot jump, no.
Okay, alright.
You mean I could have saved my botch as well? How rude.
No. that's not how botches work. I just can't think of an awesome benefit to give him, so I'm going to tell him to hold it.
It's fine.
Here's the benefit for your crit. You get to keep your crit for the next roll. All right, so you guys have managed to cross the hole in the ground that gave you guys so much trouble last time. And by you guys, I mean Zhang.
I'm feeling pretty
technically. Technically, I still fell in it. Just saying.
This one pit has given you more. I have gotten so much good PCs being fucked over out of this one pit.
One man, one pit.
Dior. So as you guys manage to land here, this curdled magic that's gone wrong, this oily blue and purple kind of thick air, this gas that hangs. It's not really a gas, though. Like, it's more like a... It's kind of damp, but in that way that, like, something covered in olive oil would be damp. Right? And so, like, it's all over you, and kind of... You feel filthy and slick, and the ground here, you get the idea that you might not want to sprint anywhere. And Asclepius will step forward, revealing...
This uncontrollable tremors or tics. Okay, so tics count as well. Yeah.
Yeah. Asclepius will step forward and he will reveal another orb. The mist seems to emanate and spill forth from this shimmering, multicolored orb. As does a energy that kind of like flows from the orb to a thick wall that you can almost see through behind it.
Does anybody say what the mist actually
is? I was waiting for the description to finish, but it's like, okay, so you might want to be wanker. Careful, the mist here is a little bit fucking cut. it's a little bit funny with magic.
That gift, by the way, if you
have. I stopped myself. I was about to just go, yeah,
full on.
Oh yep. Yeah.
Yep.
It was a tick. Sorry, but yeah, there we go. That's you get pyro. Fucking ticks, honestly. But yeah. The oil mist stuff makes your spells go asshole.
Wait, makes spells go asshole. That make no sense.
I'm sorry, I don't understand either. I know a lot about magic, but not asshole spell.
I'm sorry. Did I stutter?
You know plenty about assholes.
Maybe did stutter.
I can't give you inspiration for your personality when you've already got inspiration for your personality. This is amazing.
Do we know the source of the mist?
Why are you asking all these fucking questions about stuff when clearly I'm having fucking issues?
Perhaps those mushrooms were a little magical.
Zymac, the audience is calling for a beat. You can gain a beat. What are beats, Grant? Well, audience who's just tuning in, many of which don't know, beats are where the audience applauds something that they think is awesome, be it good roleplay, a clever plan, or something amazing, and the player who earns the beat can spend it to activate their beat feat. Everybody gets a beat feat, and it's one of the reasons I get away with being an asshole to the GM, to everybody who's not the GM. Which is the complete and total opposite of being an asshole to the GM. Oh, shut up. Gearjammer 29 says two crits for Squeegee and two botches for Zang, because this is too much fun. So that is plus one beat to Zang Mac. There is a high score per session for beats earned, by the way. That is something that we do track. So Zang, you're up to one beat earned. Alright.
Thank you. Very much, guys. I appreciate that.
So while you were clearly having fucking issues, the UNT was asking for fucking information, right?
It was a gobshite orb. Orb.
What?
This is amazing, because he's not Chris is being an asshole, but his character's not. His character is legitimately trying to understand what the hell is being said. This is so amazing. I am so glad my friends are all assholes.
I can't turn down the opportunity, Grant. I'm sorry.
I know. It's so perfect. Somebody was saying...
You doing that there magic again?
I'm just gonna point at the fucking orb.
Oh, it's the orb. Why didn't you just say so?
Damien hasn't stopped doing this because he feels like he's supposed to be doing it for this. Like, so he's, you know, some.
Apparently we're doing magic now, and Damien is helping with the magic. Yes. Like.
He's helped Hawthorne with magic before.
He has.
They opened the door together.
So yeah, they said open together. I remember that. Yeah.
So does the mist reach where we're standing?
Yes.
Does it reach back to the invisible platform?
The mist begins at the edge of the platform here.
Should we attack the orb?
Sorry, can you... ping that again, please? Okay.
This is the first row of mist.
I will take a step back onto the invisible floor.
Yes.
And I will tap my club on the stone beneath me. And I will cast Shillelagh.
That spell is awesome. But I will never be able to hear that spell's name and not laugh. Shillelagh. Shalilu! Shalalalalale! It's almost as bad as Faharlingen where the fuck, like, Fist Knuckle was. The god of travel in 3.5. Fjarlgargan!
Fist Knuckle.
Crump Knuckle! Like... alright. So, what is Shillelagh doing for you? And how does it look when you cast it?
So, snakes will slither out of my sleeves once again. And this time they will slither around the club and solidify until it glows a slight green. Why is the spell card not showing?
You gotta go in and, like, edit it and see it. I don't know why. Oh, okay, there we go. The wood or club of a quarterstaff you are holding is imbued with nature's power. For the duration, you can use your spellcasting ability instead of strength for attack and damage rolls. Wow, that's even better in 5th edition. And the weapon's damage die becomes a d8. The weapon also becomes magical if it isn't already. The spell ends if you cast again or if you let go of the weapon.
So the club counts as magical for bypassing damage.
Yes.
So I will...
Fuck you. I'm not mocking you, I'm just having fun.
So I will walk up and simply hit the...
Alright, I will not charge you a roll to hit the damn thing. However, every time you damage this with a magical weapon, I need you to roll me 1d20. On a 1 or a 2, you get a surge.
Damien
is still going. He's...
One hell of an arm workout. Yeah.
Does damage matter?
The damage done does matter. It has hit points.
Mm-hmm.
So, the challenge before you mechanically is kill it as much as you can as few strikes as you can.
As it turns out, I have a crit.
The wild magic checks are always are all natural. As per our rules for Hellmouth.
Yes.
But the attack is a crit, so you will do double the dice damage, but not double the flat number damage. So how much damage?
Yep. Holy shit.
How much?
20.
Holy fuck. Alright, so you will rear up. Did you get a 1 or a 2 on either of those rolls? For the...
No.
Okay. So you'll rear up and you'll take a swing with your shillelagh should
Shellacazam!
You'll take a swiggity swing with your swiggity shillelagh, and you'll tear a small part of it will just like as if it was made of clay. You leave a visible like rut in the thing, and it has substance, right? And the lights and colors shimmer all over it, and it kind of sparks a little, and you can feel a surge of magic released from the orb when you swing that almost sets off the curdled magic all around you.
So I will hit it again.
Tell me this is a seamlessly, infinitely looping GIF of... Nerd Immersion. It basically is. That's amazing. That's amazing,
just
Eli.
Put that over his camera for him. Give his arms a rest.
Right.
Thank you.
Yes, all right. So Leviathan. Is anybody going to do? Well, Leviathan takes a swing and takes a chunk out of it. Does anybody else want to do anything?
I'm doing all I can do, right here, casting that spell. Gonna make things happen. Gonna stop that orb, like my buddy Hawthorne told me how to do.
This guy. Fucking guy.
I fucking love Damien. I hope Damien reaches inner peace. I really do.
I wish I could play more often. I really do. I don't know if you guys do, but I do.
Alright, so nobody else wants to do anything? You're all content to just let Leviathan hack this thing down?
I'm kind of inclined to.
Alright. Alright, Kajer.
I'm very much inclined to, as it goes. Although, I'm gonna...
We'll just treat your attack dice, your attack roll for the shillelagh, as the wild magic surge. So just keep going. Nerd immersion.
Fuck.
You're looking to do 100 total damage, by the way. All right, so just let me know how many surges you get. Well, Nerd Immersion, I have a nice little conversation here.
Yep.
So you say you want to play more often.
I'd love to if I could.
So what's stopping you from playing more often, bro?
I mean, work.
Okay, so that's your first one was a crit. You're not. Then you have Nat. Then you have crit from you, me, and that's your dice gone.
Mm-hmm. I work 9 to 5, Monday through Friday, so that hurts some of it.
So you'd have to show up on Sundays.
Sundays would be. I have off this whole week for the holiday. So.
Right. Okay. So, but you can play on Sundays though, right?
I can. Yeah. I mean, not every Sunday, but you know.
But like almost every Sunday.
That would be. I'm trying because.
What about almost every Sunday?
almost. Yeah. I mean, I got a Sunday night stream I'm on. I play every other Monday with the folks from Open Legend. I do stuff over there. So I'm like involved.
All right, so take note, Kajer, buddy, because you do most of my scheduling work for me because I am a lazy fuck who offloads all of my work onto other people. Almost every Sunday, we can have Nerd Immersion. All right.
Yeah, I will. I'll run it by the wife. We'll see what she says.
you are getting a beat for this, by the way, Nerd Immersion. The audience is slowly becoming more and more impressed with your stamina.
Damien's got a 14 constitution, but Ted's got a 20 constitution for shenanigans.
How are you not rolling a single 1 or 2 this entire time? I can't.
Dude, you're doing great.
Have you done 100 damage yet? You're still going. Dude.
How many
are you just gonna like walk past the challenge with no downside because dice?
20, 32,
78 so far.
78?
So this entire time, Nerd Immersion, or I'm sorry, Ted is doing the whole thing, right? And apparently, don't stop, because at this point, like, you stop doing that, I guarantee Chris is gonna roll a 1 or 2 the moment you stop that, right? So, like, this whole time, Leviathan is just hacking this thing to pieces, right? Just slowly beating it
That's
apart.
That's 103.
Wow, you got through with no surges. I don't know what to do with my life anymore. Holy shit.
Rolling a single d8 for damage. Go fuck yourself.
So you will break apart the orb, right? Finally, you will just like it. You lopping pieces off of it like you're just chopping clay with a cleaver, right? And part of the orb will fall off, and in a shower of sparks, it'll just kind of like melt away. And then you'll keep going, and finally, the last bit of it falls apart. And how does Damien finish his spell to defeat the orb?
So he's sitting there, and he's like, just kind of. Oh man, he's thinking all about how snakes and flesh and scales, all one flesh, all one scale, going back and forth. Guy's smashing the orb. Hawthorne says, do this. He says, asshole spells. So then as he's done, as he sees the orb start to break, he just bends over and faces his ass towards the thing. And then just like... It's got the damn asshole spells. So he's got to make sure he does whatever his buddy says.
God. Perfect.
Did you just moon my challenge?
I did. What are you going to do about it? Nothing. That's right.
What the fuck? That was
the culmination of your working out on camera was to moon a challenge that has already been defeated.
I think he just poos Rodad, actually.
Poos Rodad.
You're welcome.
Oh man, it feels good to be back in Everdeep.
Out there.
All right, so that is another beat for Damien. I can't believe you squeezed 2 beats out of that one fucking thing. You managed to. You are absolutely useless this whole time, except you get all the beats.
Hey, you don't know whether or not that was channeling the anti-crit magic.
You might say that he squeezed 2 out of his asshole.
No, you might not.
No.
Thank you for the crits. Who is that? Yumi? Was it Yumi or just was it or is it Yumi and Gearjammer?
Gearjammer was the first one, and then Yumi was the second one.
Thank you both of you for assisting Leviathan in breaking down. What I will do, as a result of those crits, when you were hacking through those things, each one of those crits will result in a single attack at plus one, as if your weapon was a plus one weapon, which means plus one damage and plus one to hit. And you can choose to spend those charges at any time, but they will fade at the end of this adventure.
So I'm quite exhausted after that whole process. I will sit down on the giant snake as it slithers up behind me.
I'm gonna pat Leviathan on his shoulder, like as he's finished. We'll just walk up and be like, "Fucking ass wank! Good job, mate. Yeah."
I will look up at him. I am not your mate, but thank you.
Tits!
Nor do I have those, I'm afraid.
I can't... I don't even know... This is supposed to be a horror game, goddammit!
This was your doing!
I did not choose that one for his madness. I did, however, invite Damien to the table again. That I will take responsibility for.
I'll take a little responsibility for that.
So, as you guys somehow took an hour to get past that, that's good. I'm not complaining. I just, between the ass wanker tits and the poots roda, I got nothing. What is Bruce doing this whole time?
So, after it was over, I patted Damien on the back and said, "I haven't seen asshole magic that good since the Snake Man cast Shillelagh."
All right. So, as you guys. The magic that seemed to be powering a bit of a force field around this, it looks stone, but it's not the same as anything else. Like, okay, so around here you've got all, like, the brick and the big, thick, rough-hewn styles. This is very smooth. And judging by how far indented into the wall, it's probably very thin. And a quick, like, knock will tell you that behind it is hollow. And there is no longer a force field protecting it, allowing you to, do what, precisely?
Sit down.
Alright.
Yeah, Damien wants to take a little break, too.
Alright, so Damien is like...
Damien's worn out. He did all the work, let's be real.
I will look over at Hawthorne. Break a leg. No, except don't. Don't break anything at all if you can. Don't break... In fact, don't hurt yourself. At all.
I'll try... Wait, not to, thanks. What? You wanted me to do something exactly?
Oh, the door thing.
I'll go over to the door.
All right.
Is it locked?
It doesn't seem to have a handle. You're assuming it's a door because you've been down this way before and you know there's supposed to be a hallway on the other side of this thing.
Okay.
Does it have a keyhole? Do we just bang this thing down?
It doesn't seem to have any notches, any nublets, any knobs, any keyholes. No nipples, nothing.
Hang on, y'all. I know I'm tired, but I know how to fix this.
Open!
Does it open?
It does not, in fact, open.
You can't let it
I go and I sit back down. I go, well, I've done all I can do.
I don't know if any of you asshole noticed when we came in, but these fucking statues have moved.
Oh, since, this again?
I'm guessing last time these wankers had to look at the direction we wanted something done in.
Right, right. What direction are they looking in right now?
They all seem to be looking at where the orb was.
Got it. Got it. So y'all want to move some statues?
Can we move Asclepius away from any of the statues, please?
Okay.
I will continue sitting on my snake and it will slither back.
All right.
Want to move this one?
I mean, you could give it a go.
I'm feeling brave. Let's,
Do I have any unnatural dice lined up?
Do you have a net? Yes, you do. What you do have I? Lots.
What have I got?
You have a botch.
All right. So, Bruce.
Yeah.
These statues, which are disturbingly lifelike, as the mercenaries have learned, these are in fact petrified people. There's no telling how old these statues are, but they are, at this point, fairly crumbly. Some of the detail has eroded over probably centuries. They sit on top of these platforms that sit on top of perfectly shaped ball bearings made of stone that sit on top of mounted things. So there's a lever, and you could just pull the lever and rotate the statue. As you rotate this one into position, the moment you move it, the torso, like at the waist, will spring open. Like, and there'll be like these two metal rods inside of it that push the top half up away from the bottom half, and then there will be a huge 10-foot long like greatsword blade that kind of that ejects and swings, but it's going to malfunction and the trap will and great. it will stop just short of like hitting you.
Metatron be praised.
Thank you, Gearjammer, for that botch.
Yeah. I mean, I don't know. My dungeon delver may have saved me. I don't know. okay, so who wants to try the next one?
Did you say it was actually a longsword, or it's just a longsword-sized blade?
I said it was a greatsword-sized blade. It has anybody who is standing within two squares from the edge of the statue suffers the attack.
Oof.
Guys, I'll be right back.
Sorry. All right. Well, I know who's not opening any of the traps.
Is that how we get out of it?
I guess. Shit.
Gotta run. You want me to do another one? I'll do another one. It's fine. It's obvious that Metatron's on my side down here, given all the divine saving I've had lately. So I think I can do another one.
If you don't have inspiration, you can take it.
I already have it.
All right.
Didn't use it yet. Yeah.
So how about this guy? You want to turn this guy? Let's do it.
You turn this guy. No trap.
It's nice. All right. See, what are y'all afraid of? Metatron's got us covered. We're totally safe down here. I mean, I'm pretty sure we can turn all these and just be done with it. Anybody?
Fine. Fuck it. Fuck it.
And I'll reach a shaking hand. I'm going to move.
Wait. Bro, I think you should look a little closer at that one. It looks a little bloody.
Yes, this is the one that was trapped before, I know.
Yeah, this is the first one that was ever trapped, yep.
Yep. So I want to move people away, like, from the range of the fucking blade.
Yep.
And then I'm going to turn it.
It does not spring a trap.
Oh, shit. And then I'm going to look at I'm gonna look at Leviathan. I'm gonna point to the last one.
How about it, buddy? Wanna turn that statue?
No.
Okay.
He does not want to turn the statue.
All right, I'm gonna do it. This one up here by the pit.
He asked me a question. I answered.
Yep. You know, if you had the holy fortitude granted to you by Metatron instead of your false god Phoenix, maybe you would. Maybe you'd be a little better down here.
So as he's saying this, and you are contemplating, striking him down where he stands because he just suggested that you worship Phoenix as opposed to Medusa, the true goddess of the snake people. As if karma itself, I believe I have a crit lined up.
You do.
This one is trapped. And so he's like, as opposed to your false god, Phoenix, and he's going to get slammed by the fucking blade in the trap.
Thank you, Yumi.
I will begin casting a spell and then see that and ponder a moment.
So this is gonna be a crit, right? Oh boy, 29 damage.
So I have resistance to trap damage, so it won't be that high.
Excellent.
With Dungeon Delver.
So you take.
Also, is there any way I can make a saving throw on this?
It's an attack roll as opposed to a saving throw. So there are dice. It's the only reason you're not seeing any dice is because somebody else bought the dice. So is Dungeon Delver your feet or your beat feet?
Dungeon Delver is. Hang on. Let me pull it up. I think it's just a regular feat. It's not a beat. A beat feat is alert.
Oh, okay, so you don't have to charge a beat. So you're going to take half of that, that'll be 15 points of damage. So, like, as you pull the lever to it, this one only needed a minor adjustment, right? So you reach out, you grab the handle, and you kind of, like, pull it towards, and you can hear, like, the stone scraping on stone. And then as it clicks into place, just when you think you're free of the trap, right? Slam! And it'll slam into you and catch you off guard.
I will look over.
That crit was thanks to...
Yumi.
Thank you, Yumi. Pull the lever, Kronk!
If you ever say that I worship Phoenix again, I will kill you.
Who do you worship? Doesn't matter. Metatron loves all.
I will look over at Hawthorne and blink. Uncertain how to respond.
Asclepius will,
I'm just gonna shrug.
Asclepius will, like, reach up and he'll put a hand. Like, you're like, sitting on top of the snake and the snake is kind of, like, slithered up, right? So he's gonna, like, reach up and he'll put his hand on your foot, right? Because it's, like, right next to his head. And he will simply... And as all of the statues turn to face the door at the southern end of the hallway, you will hear, not see, but hear, because Asclepius has moved too far away for the torchlight to illuminate it, the cracking of stone as a crack develops and, like, grows and climbs up the surface, right up the center of the stone. Man, your hearing is so keen. You can tell it's right up the center. And then it will... fall apart with a loud crack and fall one tablet one way and one tablet the other. And as Asclepius steps forward, the GM will have remembered to have fixed this. Oh, not that. Oh, I ain't fixing shit. And as the tablets fall one way or the other, the passage is open. The way is clear. You can continue. As that tablet gives way and lets the air flow through the dungeon, the scent of old, dried, rotten blood and death greets you on the breeze. But to find out what it means, you'll have to stay tuned for the next 3 to 5 minutes, because it's top of the hour break. Blah, 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 dungeon, blah, blah, blah. Eli, what would you like to say?
Question.
Answer.
Can I catch a heal from someone? If not, can I cast Healing Word?
You may cast Healing Word on yourself, yes.
Great. And so that is Healing Word. Where did you go? There it is. Healing Word.
What is it?
What's the spell?
And what's your Healing Word?
Metatron-ness life give.
Justice.
Hyphenated.
You can tell I've given it lots of thought.
All right. So you actually cast that as a second level healing word, not a first level healing word. So you get another D4. That's shot. Jack's 13. $5 is crit to Kajer as thanks for all the work with the Nexus he does.
So I get another D4 roll?
Yep.
For those of you who are sitting in Nexus, Nexus happens to be our tavern-style role-playing room on our Discord server, wherein we have campaigns run by GMs. We are currently recruiting GMs for next season.
Is it fine to pull it off that way? You guys cool with it? Just 10 points?
Yeah. Go nuts. Okay, cool. 10 points. Family. All right.
Back up to 35 out of 40. Yeah, things are coming. Oh, things are coming up, yeah. Bruce.
Things are coming. Things are coming up, Bruce. All right, so Hawthorne, Asclepius. Hawthorne, you're in first, I assume, because you don't want the escort going in first.
I take my pistols out. All right. I'm gonna activate my blood rite.
All right, so how does that work?
So basically, as he shakingly draws his pistols out, he's like, and cuts the, because you know.
There's razor blades on the top of the guns, yeah. And you.
Basically, he has razor blades.
Watch that out of curiosity.
No, fuck off.
I just thought you might slit your wrists with all the switching.
Dead. Like no.
So he basically gets blood all over his weapons, and the blood will coat the weapons and sort of sink in, and then temperature will drop around him slightly, and you can see the your breath in the air and stuff like that, and that's the blood magic activated.
All right. And that gives you what, like D6 damage on every hit?
Yes.
All right. So you can step in here. Now, you remember last time you were here, Hawthorne, this
I'm
panel,
not stepping on that thing.
Yeah, yep. It's been smashed.
I don't care. I'm still not stepping on it.
Last time you were here, there was this square in the ground that had like a symbol of a snake. And as you stepped on it, it turns you to stone. The maddened you on tier are very fond of their petrification. As a means of dealing with people they don't like. So Asclepius will follow in behind you. The door opens up, and as you look to your, I think that's what, your left.
It'll be my left.
Yeah,
yep.
There'll be. I actually had to like turn and be like, which way is he looking? there is another giant staircase that sort of like descends into pitch black shadow.
Okay, fine. I'll make some tentative steps forwards, because I nearly died in this place the first time I was here.
And Chris, yes, I realize you are probably riding your summon. Like so.
What is it with Chris and his characters riding things? Is that there's a recurring theme here?
This time it's a snake.
Chris just likes a big, round, thick thing between his legs, that's all.
No, I figure it's gotta be closer to, like, real life, right?
Sentient and filled with venom? Alright, so, again, Asclepius will be manning the middle here, just in case you guys are ambushed from behind. As you step down here, Hawthorne, you remember this room vividly. You've been here on multiple occasions.
Yeah, as soon as I see a mad UNT, I want to hex it.
All right, so you're prepping an action.
I'm prepping an action.
So as you step down the stairs here, you've got memories kind of flowing through your head of the last two times you've been in this chamber.
Well, I nearly died in that spot
In that spot right there. There was a particularly bloody kill of a UNT on that square right there. And the second time you came through, all of those bodies had been dragged and their blood smeared all over the floor and pulled through a chamber to the east side of the room. And in that exact spot where that particularly bloody kill was, there is a softly pulsating blood red mushroom. Similar to those blood red mushrooms that you had seen in a previous adventure chamber, it was with a blood fountain, or mushrooms like growing up out of the cracks. In the exact spot where that death had occurred, there is this mushroom here where you almost died. You can see a sparkling small cluster of these red shrooms as well.
Was from my blood.
Yes. There is a scorch mark on the ground here. That's usually a sign for you to stop and pause. And as you descend down the stairs,
I'm actually going to go over to this spot here.
The air in the chamber seems to thicken with heat. This is disconcerting to those of you who know anything about UNT culture. Phoenix, their devil, their adversary, their evil made manifest, is a very fiery son of a bitch. And so when things UNT go fire, there's usually a problem. They revere fire as an evil divinity in and of itself. Not just Phoenix Flames, but just fire in general is an ugly necessity. It is a sin that they bear, because someone must. And as you step down here, you can see, do you remember the pits? The first time you were here, the UNT were digging, and they were digging for what you eventually learned was the Necronomicon. That has since been extracted from the basement of the manor. And now there is this very finely crafted stonework that's been kind of, like, patched over that hole. And, like, lashed in and hammered and nailed. There are, crates kind of, like, littered around the floor. They've since been looted.
Mm-hmm.
Asclepius will follow you here, opting to avoid the scorch mark. And as he does step down that final step and kind of holds his torch out to illuminate the room, you will see a small serpentine chest tucked against the far wall, surrounded by scorch marks.
I will wave a hand towards it and cast Detect Magic.
It is definitely magical. Evocation.
I'm going to draw my weapons just in case, ahead of time.
Are you dual-wielding or single-wielding?
I've got a sword. I usually just use the sword because I got a torch, but Asclepius has a sword, so I'm going to take shield.
All right. Shield. Yep.
Yeah, same here.
There's magic on that chest.
Open.
That's the chest. The chest defies find my, you like, silently.
Let's try that again. All right, maybe a little bit of bastard stuff we can we all right. 3, 2, wager, and I'll cast
open.
And you cast thaumaturgy. The chest kind of rattles and tries to open, but it is locked.
Ooh. I bet I could open that locked chest.
You'd be more than welcome to give it a go. Just watch out for those fuck, what's her name?
Medusa?
Snake?
That one. No, Medusa. Yep, Medusa.
Okay.
Most of you shouldn't watch her. She does.
We shouldn't wash her. What was that? I could
hit him with the club.
What? All right. So Bruce, you want to go and open the chest?
Oh, well, the hell not. Let's take a close. Let's take a look at it.
Give me an investigation check to like examine and deduce. Meanwhile, Asclepius will step further into the room. On the far side of the room from the stairs, there is a smeared trail of blood.
Crit, actually, thanks to Yumi.
All right.
I rolled a 20 anyway.
There is a smeared trail of blood that leads along the far side wall and behind this pillar here that blocks your line of sight. And where the blood kind of like seeps in between the cracks of the stone floor, a small host of these soft pulsing. And when I say pulsing, I don't mean like light pulsing. I mean like physically.
Ba-doom. Ba-doom.
Yeah. Like these little mushrooms have a heartbeat, right? That's Bruce.
Not weird at all.
You definitely detect there is in the top of the serpentine chest, right? You know where the chest like opens up and it does this? If it were to do this, right, the two corners closest to the person opening the chest would pull on wires that go down into the bottom half of the chest, right?
Got it.
That is a common method of like being trapped. As for the locks, you can unlock it and do so without any trouble.
Looks fishy, dudes. There appears to be a trap on this chest.
I don't understand how fish are involved in the trap.
You know, maybe they set the trap. I don't know. You'll have to ask the fish. Can we attempt to disarm this thing?
You can. The way that I run traps, I describe the mechanics and the physical reality of what's going on, and then you tell me what you do, and we don't use dice. So if you wanted to cut those wires, you could. If you wanted to like step way back and try and open the chest with a stick, you could do that. I don't use dice to disable traps. It's strictly a role-playing exercise.
Okay. So I know that if I raise the lid on this chest, two cables at each corner of the lid are going to like pull on something probably in the chest or below the chest, right? Let's cut them in the hopes that whatever that's pulling. Well, okay. Like as I, does it look like they're under a lot of tension? Or are they kind of slack, these cables?
They appear to be pretty slack.
Okay, I'm gonna cut them.
All right.
Can I move Asclepius off of those very nice stone places before he disarms this trap?
Yeah. As a matter of fact, upon your suggestion, Asclepius will come behind this pile of crates and he will like kneel down and kind of like peer over the top of the crates and he'll take cover. What is anybody else doing?
I will sit there around all of the scorch marks and come next to Asclepius.
All right. And Damien?
I'm just going to stay right where I am, but just peering over the top of my shield, watching and
open it. Sure. And this internal monologue, because I think what might be in this chest could be of great value to furthering the cause of Metatron if it were in my position. I'm gonna cut these wires and just kind of barely creak the chest open and peek inside just to kind of see, so I know what's in there before anybody else does.
All right. So go ahead and roll me perception for that peek.
We didn't use your crit. You used your roll, so you still have that crit.
Well, okay. So I've got to cut the wires, right? And then I've got to do the peek with perception. Are the wires already cut?
The wire, you're not going to have to make a roll to cut the wires. You just kind of like, you take out your sword and you gently slide it along, like opening a box from Amazon.
Do I want to use the crit on this perception check, really? Do I have to use it?
You have to.
Okay, yeah, then yeah, that's fine. Let's use the crit on the perception check.
Thank you, Yumi.
Thank you, yeah, Yumi, for the crit. So basically what I'm going to do is I am going to send you a message. Okay. I'll DM it to you on Twitter.
so you can. All right.
Are you in Discord? You want to just send me that?
Oh, line? Yeah, I'm on Discord. Are you on Discord?
I'm also in the Twitch chat. You could just whisper me on Twitch.
I can do that. Yeah.
All the options.
It's
you just write it.
Is it Hootener or Hootener?
Hootener.
All right.
And you know, if you just want to like give it to a pigeon and fly it here, we can get it that way too. Smoke signals.
Smoke signals and pigeons are my best way. My favorite. Okay, so on your crit, that is what you see.
Okay. So I'm gonna DM back to you what I take. Can I do that?
Yeah. And awesome. roll me a deception.
Would it be deception or sleight of hand?
Sleight of hand, if you've got it. Roll me sleight of hand, and also take 1 point of bad karma.
Okay.
Loot whoring is a crime against fairness.
I should have stuck with the deception. It's way higher, but okay, sleight of hand. does that pass?
No. The sleight of hand check?
Yeah.
Does anybody here have a passive perception of 13 or higher? Really? The guy you've been really racist to all night notices.
Can I use my inspiration?
Only you have to declare it before you roll.
Boo. Okay.
14 wouldn't have passed anyway. I have 15.
Okay.
That's fine. Okay. So he notices that I'm peeking in here. He's going to notice if I take something.
He's going to notice if you take something. Well, okay, you attempted to take something, and he's going to notice you before you do, right?
Okay. All right. Doing it anyway. Yeah.
I'm going to suggest you put that back.
Put what back?
The snake will slither over.
The giant goddamn snake.
What you just slid up your sleeve.
I mean, look, it's a, it's a blood crusted rope, and I believe it to be a relic of Metatron.
That's fantastic. I'm glad you have beliefs. Now put it back.
You want this blood crusted rope? Why do you need a blood crusted rope, man? Are you standing between me and my mystical coming with my Lord and Savior Metatron? Begrudgingly, I place the rope back in the chest, but understand that you are interfering with divine powers of which you have no understanding, Snake Man.
Yes, you are divine.
And so while I'm here, I reach into the chest and I tie the strings back together and I shut the lid.
All right, so
free on the trap.
That's allowed. Like,
I can obviously see him do this, right?
Well, yes, you know he's done this.
Wait, can I slide a hand to stealthily put the trap back together?
Probably not. Boo. It's fairly complex. Boo.
It's fairly complex to cut. All right,
so, Chris, my question is, do you do what I think you want to do? Because I think what you want to do is just open the chest right now. I'm pretty certain you want to set the whole thing off.
I'm not going to. I'm going to slither back, yep. And my familiar is going to open the chest behind him.
I step away.
Oh, no, while you're doing it, my familiar is opening the chest.
So you're like, you drop it in, and you're like, right? And he sees you going to set the trap back up. And, wait, your familiar or your summon?
My familiar.
Oh, you have a tiny snake familiar.
I do.
All right.
So your tiny snake is going to open a chest.
I only need to open it 2 inches.
All he's going to do is push it. And it has enough strength to deal damage to people. It can probably open a chest. So all right. So you're like, yes, yes. And as you're tying, you're like stepping up and being like, fine. And as you're going to take that step away... the GM will suddenly realize that he doesn't have that token out just yet. Just 1 second. And here's where we find out if anybody is actually far away enough from this.
Mm.
When he says that, it's a fireball.
Two, three. Oh, man, I'm... Yes! It only hits Hawthorne and Bruce. Bruce and Hawthorne, give me dexterity saves.
I crit, thanks to Yumi.
All right.
Oh, God. God, I made that roll, but can I please take inspiration on that? Never mind. I'll take it.
All right. So, that'll be 8d6, half to Hawthorne. Actually, Hawthorne, you crit thanks to Yumi. No damage.
I crit thanks to Yumi.
Yep. I'll give you no damage on that.
I'll jump back up there. Like, oh, shit. Oh, my God.
So
I will actually... I will say that... That Leviathan looks over at Hawthorne.
You take half
up the stairs.
Right. So,
you motion up the stairs.
That, this is why Hawthorne takes no damage. This is the way the crit works out, right? Is like as Leviathan is calmly moving away, right? And the paladin, I almost called you the thief. No, you are a thief. The thief is, the rogue, rather, is like, reattaching the strings, right? And the snake man is kind of walking away. He'll just, like, calmly look at you and nod to back up onto the stairs.
Right.
And so you back up onto the stairs, and then, all too late, the rogue realizes that there's a snake slithering up the side of the chest, and you had just tied that together, and you go, oh, fuck, and the snake just, like, it does this, like, and it opens the chest. And that'll be 25, but that halves to 13 damage from fire, because you take half damage from traps.
Yeah. Hang on. In the wake of the explosion, I will look towards the rogue. It seems the divine work in mysterious ways after all.
I brush the ashes off my leather armor and say nothing.
That was a little bit business close with the fire there. I appreciate the nod. I will say,
in the chest you find what did I say was there? In the chest, you find 2 points of adventuring gear, 60 coins, and 100-foot length of blood-crusted rope. Those of you who are savvy might go, but Evil Squeegee, isn't a length of rope adventuring gear? To which I say, yes. Yes, it is. That might be a significant item of some kind that is not actually adventuring gear.
I will look towards Hawthorne. Do you know much about enchanted items?
I don't, as it goes. Here, Bruce, you got this wanker rope that's in here. I've not got much use for it.
Sure. I won't take it.
Why? Whoa. Why do you get to take the rope? Excuse me?
I'm simply holding on to it until we find out what it is.
I see. Okay.
Sclepius, can you bring that light down here? I think I saw something in that explosion.
You did. In fact, find another chest. Now, who gets those 2 points of adventuring gear?
I'm full. I've got space for one if no one
I
else
think they both have a space for one, I think.
Who Bruce and
No, I think Damien and
Hawthorne. Oh, Damien and Hawthorne both have one. Well, there's 2 points, so you guys are both back full. Okay. And then there were 60 coins, which if you divide by four...
It's 15.
Is 15 coins each. There is another serpentine chest here.
Actually, I will give the rope to Asclepios as a sign of my... sincerity.
All right. Asclepios will take the rope and he will ask you, do you have any coins?
I'll hand him the coins I just got from the chest.
15?
Yes.
He will take the coins and he will mutter a small prayer and he will hand the rope back to you. He says, "The rope animates itself. You need only feed it your own blood."
So I guess you got two giant snakes now.
Were you going towards the second one, Hawthorne?
I stopped.
Just, dude, Leviathan, can you just get your snake to open the second chest?
I will cast...
Bruce said shade throwingly.
The second chest does not show any signs of magic.
Right. That doesn't mean shit.
I will attempt to have the familiar open the second chest.
All right. The second chest, this poor familiar, which, by the way, you had to resummon after the fireball, because the fireball kind of incinerated it. So you had to pull out another one. So the second chest, when it is opened, is a blade, which will destroy this poor familiar again. It's a blade trap, right? A blade will swing out of the top of the chest and just, like, chop this poor snake in half. The sides of it will fall over, and then it'll dissipate into smoke, and you can have it crawl out of your arm again. Like, out of your sleeve, where it seems to perpetually emit from. This chest contains 2 antitoxin, which are a consumable that you can use to cure infection, 1 stack per use, and 500 coins.
Oof.
125 each.
So everybody gets 125 coins. Where do those 2 antitoxin go?
I have no use for such things.
I mean, no one else is stepping up. I'll fucking take one.
Like, all right.
Yeah. Like... If people are, like, looking reluctant, I feel... You know what? I'm entitled to one of those. I'm taking it.
You can take your giant personality inspiration. Who wants the last one?
I'm a paladin. I'm good.
I mean, I'll take it, yeah.
All right, so...
No, I don't want it.
As you guys are looting these things, right... You are suddenly aware of a crackling sound behind you. From somewhere, the GM suddenly realizes that he didn't enable anybody's chance to see any of this, so he has to turn that on now. As you are looting the chest and going over and divvying up the coins, somewhat distracted, the heat in the room starts to make sense. You don't know where they seem to have come from, because they appeared when you were distracted, but these are mutated, magically warped UNT of great size, and they are a bright, heat, golden, fiery orange. Leviathan, you actually recognize that they were at one point, judging by the shapes of their bones and the particular patterns of their scaling, they were blue. But no longer. They have been corrupted by the magic of Phoenix. And that is going to be initiative. But before we continue, I do need to know, do we have time to finish a battle or do you guys need to bail at 3 at 1 o'clock?
Right at 1.
Damien's got to leave right at 1? All right,
yeah,
so...
I got a conference call, but we'll see.
So...
My hex goes off.
I got 2 crits on deck, so...
Yeah. All right, so let's do this speedy. Like, who wants to roll a net?
My hex goes off.
Yep. Who wants to roll a net?
I have a plus 4 dex.
Zero.
I mean, I have negative 1. So.
I think the rogue probably.
Minus 2.
I rolled a 19, so we'll take that.
All right, so we're going to initiate, like, super speedy here, right? Oh my god, don't make me roll dice every fucking time. How did that happen? Automatically roll 3D dice, goddamn. All right, so, what did I get? Who's going first?
12, we did.
All right, PC's actions. Who wants
to
go first?
I'm going to use the giant octopus form as a Hydra.
That works. Do you want a Hydra token? Because I have one.
Yeah, just shifting to a Hydra token, I will literally turn myself and my snake, jump off the back of the snake, and turn into a Hydra mid-jump, and come down on this motherfucker right here.
And you're using the stats of the octopus form?
Of the giant octopus, yeah.
What size is it? Is it huge or...?
It's in the... Check the familiar book. It's... Or the familiar section on the sheet. CR2.
What size is it?
I think it's huge.
Alright. A huge Hydra you become. I'm gonna leave your token on board just so you can stop moving it.
Okay.
Alright. So you're gonna go full on fucking Hydra.
I don't have the
Squeegee, Karma.
Oh yeah, Karma, guys. Alright, so what is Karma? Karma is, at the start of every fight, we determine who gets slapped with their bad Karma. Good Karma is something that anybody can spend any time. So what we're gonna do is we're gonna roll a Destiny token. Karma around the table. Zhang, you have 3. How much do you have, Bruce?
So I have 1, but I think it's from the last game. If it doesn't persist, I guess...
No, you just gained 1, and you do have...
Yeah, it does persist. So, 3, 2, what about you, Damien?
Bad Karma, you mean?
Yeah.
I'm good.
All right, and I don't think you have any, yeah. So if anybody wants to, I'm also getting ready to bust out the Karma table here.
Grant, can you toss me two monster sheets for my journal, and I'll manage those so you don't have to?
Yes. All right, so it's going to be green and blue.
Fuck's sake.
The only people with bad karma. Can you both please roll me 1d6?
The fuck did that even happen? 5.
Oh, it's me, right?
Yeah.
Both of them.
They both rolled 5?
Have a 5, yeah. Yep.
All right, on a 5. You fail all your saving throws and have all attacks against you succeed for the duration of the encounter.
Jesus Christ.
Lose half your bad karma afterwards. In this case, there are no dice being rolled here, so you can't eat botches or crits from those things. And that's against blue and green, right? Okay, so...
Wait, say that again. So that because they hit automatically, it means you don't actually use a crit or a botch against us?
Yes. Correct. There are no dice rolled. Okay. It's an auto hit and an auto fail.
That's fine.
In those circumstances, all right? So you spend your action shifting, right, Leviathan?
That's a bonus action.
All right, what do you spend your action with?
I'm going to attack with both myself and my snake. That's what I was asking for the monster sheets.
And you need the octopus, you said?
Octopus and the giant constrictor. They're both CR 1 and 2, respectively.
The giant octopus, adding this to your sheet, the DM... Fuck it, it's all players. And what was the other one?
The constrictor snake at CR2.
Constrictor. Giant constrictor?
Yeah.
And can be edited and controlled by all players.
Oh god, that's the thing I use in Hellmouth. That's ridiculous, that thing.
I didn't get the
first... I'm working on it. Okay. You strangely had the chance to edit the sheet, but not have it in your journal.
Okay.
Alright, so...
I will actually make the constrictor... Constrict.
Alright, do you have any botches lined up?
That's a good question. No, I have a crit.
He has a crit.
Alright, crit from who?
This would be from Jack, actually.
Alright, so... you're gonna move in, and you're gonna crit. What does constrict do?
Target is grappled, escape DC 16.
Alright, the giant constrictor is going to take 5 damage. The salamander is on fucking fire.
Why the fuck?
You're
supposed to be damaged there, but I'm getting a syntax error for some
reason. That's fine. How much damage is it?
I got it.
Just manually roll it.
Yep.
Okay, so I'm taking 9?
Oh, it's... God damn it. Because it's doubled, because it's a crit.
Minus another 7.
And then my attack if I'm missing anything, I'll catch up to it while the other people are taking their actions.
Yep, I'm waiting for my mouse to take over. Who wants to go next?
I'll go. I'm going to move up between these two guys. 30 feet.
All right.
Then I'm going to pull out my sword, and I'm going to swing at this first salamander, which is a crit, because I have two crits lined up. A gear jammer is the first one.
This one is wounded.
You have a crit and then a nat roll. Okay. Yeah, the double dots is the is
all right, so
roll.
Would you like to smite on your crit swing?
Absolutely.
All right. And then give me a roll against AC 15.
Okay, so first, should I just roll the AC 15 one first, or?
Go ahead, I don't care.
All right, well, here's, we'll just do this. So this is the...
Oh my god, really? Nat 20, for real?
Wow.
All right, so, I don't know, I'm in sort of a rush here, so have some faith. You're stupid, snakes. I fucking hate you. I'll make you all history, and I'll hit them both.
History! You can take inspiration for your love of prayers and roll me two critical smites. Holy shit.
And I am blowing both. I'm going to blow both second level slots. So it's 3d8 critted. So that's 6d8.
Oh my god. So that's 12d8.
So that first one, that first swing looks like that's.
That's 14 plus 68.
Plus.
They're actually both grappled, Grant. I'm going to jump on the other one as the Hydra and grapple that one, too. I'll take the damage. Fuck it. I don't care.
So the one gets 38 damage from the looks of it. And then the second one will get 16.
I swear to...
This is a new high score incoming, by the way.
Plus 16, that's another 48 to the second one.
So somebody calculate the total damage done. You just killed it, by the way.
So hang on, your first one was how much?
36
melee damage record by
Damien.
Holy crap. And that was so without
the Hydra wraps around it, and the fucking paladin's just like, die, 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 die!
So, like, the Hydra is, like, wrapping itself around this snake, right? And Damien just comes, he's got his sword ready, he comes flying out, and this is with one-handed weapon, because he's got a shield in his other hand, right? And, as the Hydra's got, like, its necks all wrapped around this giant, like, writhing, seething knot, and you look for the fiery part, right? You're gonna take 10 damage. From the fire, right? But you, like, you look up and you start to pray and your sword starts, and it's a stupid little rhyme about snakes being stupid in history, and then you're just like, BOOM! BOOM! And every time your sword sinks into the flesh of this thing, not only does your hand burn, but the entire snake shudders as if it has been filled from the inside out with magma and lightning until it just falls apart in a screaming pile of agonized death. So that's the Hydra and Damien going. I was worried this might take too long. All right, so, Bruce?
Yeah, I'm just kind of blown away at what just happened.
Holy shit. So,
yeah, and suddenly the rogue understands why you don't fuck with the druid.
I mean, I'm still going to fuck with him, but, I'm going to go after that other salamander, I guess. And do I get a sneak attack on that?
If he's yes.
Yeah.
Yeah, you can you can go over here.
Like right here? Yeah. Oh, sorry. Okay. So dude, walk me through this. I'm sorry.
All right. So, do you crit or botch?
Do I get a choice?
Let's have a quick look. No, he's natural dice.
All right. So, you're going to click your melee weapon.
Which is the short sword.
The short sword, right? You have advantage. A 13 will whiff. Okay. Rogues only get one strike a round. Okay. But next time you swing, you will also have advantage, and there's a chance for another sneak attack. But you didn't hit. You also don't take 5 points of damage because it reflects, because they're made of fire, basically.
Right.
But you're fine.
So can I just disengage?
Disengage is a bonus action. You can. Yes.
Yeah. So we're gonna do that.
All right.
If I just totally missed the shot.
You can take 5 feet away. That's all the movement you left.
Okay.
All right. Hawthorne, you're up.
So I've got my guns out already.
Yep.
I've hexed the salamander. I'm going to run up, and I'm just going to open up with my pistols, like, as soon as I'm in range, because they have, like, a 20-foot
Your
range.
Your hex is already there, so you can go a full round.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. But I'm going to run up, and I'm just going to start opening fire as soon as I get within 20 feet. However, my first shot is a botch, thanks to Gear Jammer.
All right.
And my second shot would be a natural roll. However, I'm at disadvantage, so I'm going to be using my inspiration to make that a natural roll.
All right. You're at disadvantage because of your madness. Okay, so what we're going to say is your first shot, it'll hit, but you're going to lose the gun.
Okay.
The shot will go off, the shot will land, but the gun will be useless. It'll jam and not be usable until the end of the Avenger.
Okay. Okay. Well, there's the first one, which I miss with it anyway.
All right.
So that's the botch one. And then the second one is... Oh, my God, really?
You hit.
Oh, there we go. Okay. Okay. So...
I got to check to see if they have vulnerability to cold, because they might actually have vulnerability
okay,
to cold.
Okay, well, all of this is cold from the pistols because of the Hades ammo pouch.
Oh, my God. Please tell me they have vulnerability to cold. I'm going to double check. Where the fuck did the monster sheet go? God damn it. Don't close it and then hide it. Don't be a fool, Grant. Damage vulnerability is cold, so you deal double damage.
Okay.
On your one hit. This is flat, by the way. Total damage doubled. This isn't a crit. This is doubled.
Okay. So that's just from the pistol. This is from the Crimson Ray. It's not going to be as impressive.
So that's 9.
Plus... Oh, good God, really? All right,
really? So it's 18 plus 2 is 20 damage?
Yes.
All right, so... So you land your shot. You can then make your offhand attack, by the way.
That was the offhand. So my first one, the gun fucked up. So that's my main hand.
You get a total
gone.
Of 3 attacks. You just can't use that one gun.
Okay.
So you can use that gun. You're going to have to reload it on your next action, though.
Okay, so my second shot with the offhand then is my botch from Gear Jammo. So, yeah. I have another botch. That's it.
Oh.
So, botch!
Do you want to hit and lose the gun?
Sure.
All right. Fuck it. Roll the hit, lose the gun. I'm only doing that because we're pressed for time.
Yeah. So, again, cold... Oh, this is going to be a bit
All right, better. 20 so far. 26.
So 26
plus
30.
4 is 30 damage.
How much did I get from the first one?
It's almost dead.
It's 20 and 30.
Yeah.
Oh, that's 50. That's okay. That's respectable.
All
did
right.
you take the damage from the Constrictor Grant?
No. How much damage does Constrictor do?
The Constrictor did 16.
It literally has 4 HP left, which I am comfortable just letting it not have because we've got 4 minutes to go. So these salamanders, where do they come from? Crackling, screaming, howling, rage, right? And they come out of there, they're muttering curses in the Yuan Teeth snake language, threatening you with the power. You have entered the holy ground of Phoenix, right? And as they bear down, like, the first thing the druid is just like, fuck this, goes full on Hydra, his constrictor snake moves in, and while those motherfuckers are all tied up, the paladin is just like, da-da-da-da-da-da, the history, stab, stab, and the thing just fucking implodes, and then as Eli is coming around, Bruce, like, rolls in behind and makes a slash, right, but he can't land the strike. He whiffs and he backs up, but while he has the salamander so distracted, that's where Hawthorne walks up as the salamander is distracted and just unfucking loads, and he just unloads a trio of frosty bullets, and each time the guns shoot, because he's using the ammo from the ammo pouch of Hades, the bullets leave as, like, these icy, frosted bullets on top of what they would normally be. And he just blasts through, and these things just tear right through the flesh of this, and every shot is accompanied by the howl of the damned. And the salamander just shudders and falls over dead. Like, they ambushed you and didn't even get a fucking turn. And that was almost by the books. I gave you guys 4 extra damage. That was all I gave you. And you literally one-rounded a pair of salamanders, which, by the way, were worth a total of 1,800 each for a total of, 3,600 divided by 4 is 900 experience points each. And don't forget your 125 coins. In the wreckage, in the aftermath of the battle here, holy shit, you guys finally survived an entire escort quest and succeeded. You will in fact find the body in a pile of bloody mushrooms behind the pillar. You will all thus be awarded 100 XP for a successful completion of the adventure. You will all also earn a point of good karma for holding your word to Asclepius as your quest giver. And Asclepius will give you each 1 favor of 25 gold or less.
Was he paying us as well, or was that just the...
Say what?
Was he paying us as well, or was that...
I'm included that. That's your 50 gold is your payment, right? And then you get a 25 gold favor from the UNT. That can't be cashed in for cash. It has to be something of 25 gold or less from the UNT camp.
What's the level XP amount? Is it 7,500?
Yeah, 75. Did you ding?
That's it. Ding.
Bing! Is that your last milestone?
That's the last milestone.
Your next adventure is Hawthorne's final adventure. So, I'm Evil Squeegee. I've been your Dungeon Master today. Sorry for the little rush combat there at the end, although I didn't actually have to rush it because holy fuck, Nerd Immersion. God damn! The druid and the paladin were just like, yeah, whatever.
Four first level smites. I still had a way to get advantage on every attack, and I had 2 crits still in the hole. This was gonna end pretty quick, one way or the other.
It's okay. The druid and his constrictor snake had about 150 total HP to burn through, so.
I'm gonna have to step up my game. Damn, son! That was intense. Thank you all for tuning in. Don't forget to check out Zangmac _ on his channel. In roughly an hour and a half or so, he'll be going live-ish, I'm guessing, now that I've thrown you under the bus for your own channel. Beep, beep! And then tune in on Mondays to see Kajer run his world-building show. Tune in tomorrow on Thursdays to see both Zangmac and Kajer pretend they are werewolves. Eli, Hooper, thank you for playing again. It is always a pleasure. even with the druid is being an asshole. And I will catch you guys tomorrow on this channel, 10 a.m. EST. Don't miss it. Adios, amigos.
See you later, guys. I gotta run. Bye.